Past the Vasool, baby.
Come on in.
Well, hello, Screamers! Welcome again to another episode of Scream Until You Like It podcast. Hopefully, if you're still with us, you're screaming and you're liking it. So, I am Coroner Clint today, which is a reference to a movie that we're talking about, and Mikey Goes to Hell is right alongside me. Normally, I'd call him Evil Mike. We could still do that. You know, how's it going, Mike?
I'm good.
You're good? You're good?
I'm good.
Survived another week of work.
Another week down.
Uh-huh.
And I'll close my eyes and it'll be Monday again.
That's right. I know exactly what you're saying. I feel it coming. It's like rearing over my shoulder as we speak.
Yes.
Yeah. But anyhow, we just had a Friday the 13th a week ago. And one of the things that people like to do is watch Friday the 13th movies. Actually, there was a fan film that came out, Never Hike Alone 2 came out, and I checked that out. I actually thought that was pretty good. I wasn't shocked that it was good because I liked the first one. So I was fully expecting the second one to be cool too. I don't know. Do you watch any of those fan films?
I watched the first one a long time ago. I didn't watch the new one that came out yet, but I intend to. Tom Matthews is in it, right?
That's right. That's right. With a pretty prominent role, actually. So they got him for a good chunk of that movie. I don't want to spoil anything. It's one of those things where it's free up on YouTube. If you got the time to sit there and watch it, go check it out. You know, it's some Womp Stomp Films. They did that. Pretty cool time if you like Friday the 13th. And the fam films are one of the things that kind of just fills the gap, you know, as we wait for more movies to come, you know. It's like, I don't think anybody would have known how big the Friday the 13th franchise was going to become and how much of a following it would have. You know, it's, I mean, good Lord, you look at the first movie, it's like Betsy Palmer didn't think anybody was going to watch the movie.
Yeah.
She did it because she wanted the paycheck because she had her eyes on a car. She's like, nobody's going to watch this movie anyway. Little did she know.
You know? Yeah, not only the regular movies, but even like all the fan films it spawned, and it's a huge franchise.
Yeah, yeah. So this is one of those franchises that you know, they kept making, you know, installment after installment to try to milk more money out of this thing. I'm pretty sure that's the reason, you know what I mean? The studio was like, oh man, we got a freaking cash cow here. You know, that's why when they killed Jason in part 4 and then they went to part 5 and everybody got mad about, you know, the copycat Jason, the studio was like, oh shit, we're about to lose, you know, this amazing thing. We better change things up. So they killed the storyline after that movie. They canceled all the contracts to anybody they were going to ask back. And they had, you know, Tom McLaughlin, you know, write a movie.
Yeah.
The first time we got Zombie Jason.
It's my favorite Friday. And my first Friday. The first Friday I've ever seen.
Yeah. Yeah. I think my first one was part 5. That's part of the reason why I like it so much.
I saw parts Jason Lives in the movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
And the rest is history. And then,
yeah.
And I went back and filled them all in. But I know nobody would have. Because you know why? You know what? They could come out with a new one next week.
Yeah.
And people like me and you, whether even if we know it's not going to be good, people like me and you are going to see it.
It's exactly right. You know, that's why, you know, when people bitch about all the Halloween movies, you know, and how they don't like the treatment of it. Do I like every single one of them? No, I don't. Did I like the last one? Absolutely not. You know, but if they make another one, you're darn tootin', I'm going to go watch it.
I mean, I mean, they can come out with Jason Goes to Band Camp. And you know what? They're going to get my money. Yeah.
Exactly.
But they're
going to
get it.
I bet he'd be a drummer anyhow. Yeah. So I think we can agree around part six was where that started getting weird, you know, as if it wasn't weird before, you know, but it got weirder and weirder as the movies went on, you know, like part seven was basically, you know, Jason up against, you know, a Carrie type character, you know what I mean?
Yes.
You know, part eight, I'm not even exactly sure what was happening in that movie.
You know me, with part eight, I'm conflicted. I find part eight entertaining as a movie.
Uh-huh.
I hate the fact that it's in New York.
Uh-huh.
Because, yeah, you know, I'm the first, I live in New York my whole life, and I hate it.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of New York. But you know what? I'll go to bat for them and say, we don't have frigging 50-gallon drums of toxic waste just sitting on corners.
Yeah.
Our sewers don't flood with toxic waste at midnight every.
Mm-hmm.
Hate any movie that's based in New York because they paint such a picture of it.
Yeah,
and
I know what you mean. I've heard you call New York a shithole, but it's not that much of a shithole.
No,
I mean they like from the opening scene. Like my thoughts on the way they depicted New York with people just like doing drugs, you know, right there in the middle of the alleys and the toxic waste on every corner. I was like, this is like Tromaville or something.
It's like the streets are all desolate and everything. Yeah. I'm like, have you walked in New York? There's like a thousand city.
Yeah,
there's a thousand people on every block.
It's like somebody watched the Toxic Avenger and they thought that's what New York looked like.
Yeah.
Anyhow. So this movie was kind of no exception. The stories were getting pretty wild in the Friday the 13th franchise. Of course, I should mention, we're talking about Jason Goes to Hell. You know, applause.
The final
Friday. Yeah, spoiler alert, was not, in fact, the final Friday.
If you don't know by now, it wasn't.
Yeah, yeah. If you just crawled out from under a rock, there were a couple more after this. This one was interesting in the way it was written. And I should say that this was also a turn in the franchise. After part eight, I guess Paramount was kind of done with the Friday the 13th franchise.
Well, they got not only a little, they got like campy.
Yeah.
You know, like the early ones before six, they had the teenagers, but it was pretty more straight edged, a little darker.
Yeah.
He's got like a different class of teenagers, and it was a little more comical, a little more, you know, it didn't have the same feel as before it.
Yeah.
And then this one, they were supposedly, you know, going back to their, you know, they brought back Sean Cunningham and was supposed to go back to basics and back to
and part of that had to do with the fact that New Line Cinema came in. So they made a deal with New Line Cinema. They couldn't sell the entire Friday the 13th name. So that's why this one doesn't have a Friday the 13th name attached to it. But they could sell Jason, and that's exactly what they did. So New Line acquired the rights, and Sean Cunningham got excited to get involved again because he thought, oh, shit, you know, something else I can make money on, I guess.
We should go on record saying that me and you are ambassadors for this movie because not all our friends don't like.
You know,
me and you enjoy this movie more than anybody.
I don't think any of our friends like this movie.
Well, you know what? Fuck them hosers. As us Italians say, baffangul.
Oh, you shit.
Take a walk.
Yeah.
This movie's awesome.
Yeah. So.
And they know who they are, too.
Oh, they know. They know who they are.
Fuck you. Fuck you. You know who all of you are.
Yep. We won't call you by name, but we know.
We know. You know.
So I should mention, you know, it was kind of weird that, you know, they get with a new studio. You know, they actually got a new director. I mean, they got Adam Marcus involved. Now, Adam Marcus hadn't yet done a feature film when they gave him this movie, you know, and that was one of the confusing decisions that was made. But the way I understand it, since I did watch a few Adam Marcus interviews and even got to talk to him one time on the other podcast, Amityville Horror, he was a script writer. So he basically went from like doing plays and stuff to writing because he was a playwright before, and I ran a theater company for years, and he was writing scripts, and he wrote a script that he was supposed to direct. And he was longtime family friends with Sean Cunningham, who was going to help him get his script sold. But instead of, you know, selling it and getting him the ability to direct it, he sold the movie to Disney, and they wanted somebody else to direct it. So basically, he owed him one, since he promised he'd let him direct. Now the movie in question I was talking about, I forget exactly what it was called.
You know,
my boyfriend's a zombie or something like that.
And I saw it no more than because as I was eating the questionable Chinese food, I had on a YouTube video about it, and they flashed the title, and I totally forgot it.
Yeah, it was something like that. But what we know it as, what Disney turned it into, was My Boyfriend's Back.
Yes.
So that love story with the zombie and, you know, going to the dance and all that stuff, you know, fun movie if you ever saw it.
It's a funny movie.
Yeah. But at any rate, that was what, you know, got Sean Cunningham to owe one to Adam Marcus. So basically, they got this new Friday the 13th film coming out, you know, that they're supposed to make. He's like, he made a deal with them. You know, apparently, as the story goes, according to Adam Marcus, he's like, if you can get the damn hockey mask out of the movie, I'll let you write and direct it. So now they disagree on that point. So I don't know who's right, but I mean, as far as I'm concerned, you know, I like this movie. I like what Adam Marcus did with it. So I'm going to take his side of the story.
Well, I heard that was his idea to have Jason take the shape of other people.
Mm-hmm.
So, which I thought was a good idea. Regardless what was on screen, I give the guy credit because he did something really different.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he didn't try to just do the old Jason in the woods killing.
Yeah.
You know, he did something different. And I thought it was still, you know, you get, like I said, you get the people that, oh, it's not Jason. He doesn't have his hockey, man. I mean, This is a fun movie, and I kind of like Jason jumping from body to body.
Because
it also gave you like a thing vibe, like the thing.
Because
you didn't know who was, you know, at one point you didn't know who Jason was.
Exactly. That's a good point. I didn't think of it like that. You know, and there's always the purists out there, and one of the reasons why they hate this movie is because they're like, you know, the formula was working, you know what I mean, about camp slashers. Well, you know, sorry, you know, we're 9 movies in you know, how many more, you know, of Jason killing people to camp do you really want?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, got to liven up the story a little bit. So I didn't have any issues with trying something different. I will be honest about this. The first time I saw it, I didn't like it.
Okay.
You know, because I didn't get it. I didn't get what he was trying to do. I didn't really understand the story. I was disappointed I didn't have more Jason Voorhees in it. You know what I mean? All the things that people complain about to this day. But years later, I watched it again, and I was like, son of a bitch, why didn't I like this before? No, it's like I was just in a different mindset. I already knew what wasn't going to happen, so I gave the story a chance. You know what I mean? And I liked it a lot better the second time. And I've watched it a couple times since then. I still like it. I don't care if you hate it. Hey, it's a movie. It's art. It's subjective. You know, it's in the eye of the beholder. You know, if you're entertained by it, that's all you need, man. unfortunately, this movie was plagued with issues. You know, a bunch of reshoots, bunch of callbacks, you know, Sean Cunningham having to get directly involved, you know, and then, of course, not trusting some of the work. And then and that was some of the reason for why they did reshoots and they added things into the movie. Some of the scenes that are the most memorable were add-ons.
Yes. I read that a lot. There were a lot of reshoots.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and of course, the original cut was over 2 hours long, you know, and the studio's like, what the fuck? We can't have this long, you know, who's going to sit there for this, you know? So they ended up doing a pretty, pretty good hack job on the movie. And like, they edited it down to what we have. And I tell you, if they had cut any more out of it, it would barely be coherent.
You're right.
You know what I mean?
Right, it's, about that.
In fact, I would like to see it restored. I don't know if there's a director's cut out there anywhere, if they ever did that. But
I actually just heard on a video now, there actually is a director's cut somewhere.
I feel like I need to find that. Yeah. I feel like I want a copy of that.
Well, you know what it was? By making it short, as much as I like the movie, it's like they just threw stuff at you. It's like, mm-hmm. Okay, Erin Gray, and they're obviously family members of Jason. I would have liked to know, like, how? Like, who is this? Is this, you know, Betsy Palmer's niece or somebody? Like, give something. It's just like, they're relatives of Jason. Just take our word for it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's...
Yeah.
You know, they didn't give any background on that. Like, you know, obviously the town, and they know the obviously the people in the town know Erin Gray is related to Jason Voorhees.
Yeah.
But like, that's just what you see out there. It's like they don't elaborate on any of it.
Yeah. And some of that may have been explained in things that got cut out. I mean, I know, like, specifically when I got to talk to Adam, you know, I talked about, you know, Creighton Duke not having a backstory. And he's like, well, he did.
He did.
It just got cut.
It got.
I was like, oh, shit.
Same thing with him. It's like, how does he know all this? Where did he get that magic knife? That it's like, he just came in. It's like, you know.
Yeah.
And I think I read that the story with him is Jason Voorhees killed his girlfriend. And that's what prompted him to go on this quest for Jason.
Yeah, that's interesting. Creighton's Duke's character, they describe him as a bounty hunter in the film, and that he caught some of the country's most prolific serial killers. And basically he was setting his sights on Jason Voorhees. Like, they did a news piece on it in the middle of the movie, you know, and I'm like, that's kind of interesting, you know. And he had one of the most confusing lines and one of the greatest lines at the same time, you know. And I really thought that was a strange thing in the news piece where he was like, I've got two words for you. You tell me the first thing that comes in your mind, you know,
yeah,
Jason Voorhees. And he's like, first thing I think of is a little girl in a pink dress pushing a hot dog through a donut. And I'm like, what the fuck does that mean?
Oh, yeah, that's.
So there was some cool stuff in this movie. I don't know. What do you say this thing cost?
The budget was $3 million.
Okay.
And it totaled $15.9 million at the box office.
Okay. So I think even for the time, $3 million was kind of like a small sum of money, you know, to make a movie with. I mean,
yeah.
When I think about it, you know, that's kind of like the numbers that you'd hear about with like Full Moon movies, you know, people like Charlie Band and stuff like that going out trying to make a movie for a little bit of nothing and make as much as they can off of it.
Well, maybe that's a reason. That's possibly a reason why we got less Jason in makeup.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, be easier just to throw some makeup on somebody and say, oh, that's he's Jason. He's possessed, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. So this movie to me did not feel slow at any point. I feel it was paced really well. I felt like it had a good energy to it. And they don't waste any time. I mean, they drop in with the opening scene. First of all, I think they gave you just about every trope they could give you. In fact, I think that was the intention.
That was like fan service. It's like they gave you a classic hot chick in the woods opening. Like they gave you everything that you've seen in every other Friday the 13th. They threw to one scene. I thought it was great. The only thing I hated about it was the chick's unfriggin'. The chick that tied the greatest towel of any.
That did not
come out for friggin' shit. She fell off the banister. She was running through the woods. That towel didn't fucking move.
Yeah. It's like it was taped on or something, you know. Yeah, she gets in there, turns on the lights. The light doesn't work. It blows out right away. She goes and it, like every second, everything she does, you think she's about to get attacked because like they show her in a dark place. They show dark behind her, you know, like in the one scene she was standing there in front of the sink and you could see like between the slats of the closet behind her. You know what I mean? I was like, oh, is he coming out of the closet? You know, so she changes the light bulb, immediately takes a shower. So you get her naked for a couple of seconds. Lights goes out as soon as her toe hits the water of the tub. And it's like, you know what's on. She throws the towel on with the best knot that's ever been tied on a towel. And I mean, holy shit. She like flew over a banister and landed on a coffee table and the thing stayed on.
Yeah. My immaturity took over big time there because I was just like, when is this towel? It's like I started forgetting about everything else going on. I was like, when is this towel going to fall off? And it never did. I was like, God damn it.
Yeah. She was pretty well doing a hurdle race outside, hopping over logs and running up hills, you know.
And she wasn't even holding the towel, like saying, like, she was like running and it was like, it just stayed. It was just like.
And then when they turned all the lights on, she did that running, like leaping somersault, you know, and it still stayed on. And right before they blast the shit out of him and then blow him up. So
that was more scene. Unbelievable than Jason Voorhees being real.
Some people complain about the look of Jason in this movie. I'll be honest, he looks different than most other of the films.
Yes.
But I kind of get it. He wanted him to look waterlogged, I believe. You know, freaking guy died in the lake. He's been in the lake for a long time. You know, he should be waterlogged, like a freaking corpse that's bloated up.
Yes.
So, I mean, it looked weird for that reason, but I think that was done on purpose. You know, so I kind of just accepted that. I'm like, yeah, well, he is dead, and he does live in a lake.
Like chewed away almost. It's like,
yeah,
very. There's actually a comic. It was put out by Topps, and it's Jason Goes to Hell, the Final Friday. It's 3-part series. I actually went to buy it on eBay because I read that it bridges the gap between Jason Takes Manhattan and this one.
Okay.
And so I was curious, but it was like $50 for like the 3 comics. So I was like, I'm still going to get them. And I couldn't find them digitally anywhere. So they were put out by Topps, not like Marvel or DC or Image. Yeah.
Topps is the baseball card company, yes, isn't it?
But okay. They do put comics out.
Okay.
And like I said, I couldn't find it. I would even bought a digital copy just to read it.
Yeah.
To see what it said. And I can't, but I'm on it. I'm going to see what it actually says, but I'm curious.
Yeah, no, that would be cool. I, you know, I'm intrigued enough, you know, in the story to look at things like that myself. So if you do find it, and you think it's good, you know, fill me in. Let me know
absolutely
what you learn. Because it's not like I'm going to go out and buy my own copy of that stuff. Maybe I will someday, but it's doubtful. So if you do it, I want to hear about it.
Will do.
All right. So they collect up his body parts basically in a bag and they take it off to a facility to basically do an autopsy on it. And this might sound funny, but I think the coroner is one of my favorite characters of this movie.
Ah, he's great.
Played by Richard Grant. And I think that scene is probably one of my favorites in the movie. Because it's so simple, but but the lighting is cool. The atmosphere is awesome. He's sitting there, you know, poking through and like manipulating the blown up body parts of Jason Voorhees, you know, recording to his little mic that's dangling from the ceiling like he's doing a podcast, you know.
And when, like I said, I saw this in the movies when it first came out.
Yeah.
When he ate that heart, the whole theater was like, ah! the whole thing. So, and that sound he made where you're like, oh, when he eats it.
Yeah. Oh, man, it was so gross. You know, but it was really cool that he was sitting there. I mean, that was a really neat way to do that, I thought. You know, that possession scene, I thought, was super well done because the heart just started pulsating again, like beating on the table. And he's like taken aback by it and he's in disbelief.
And then he's kind of confused.
Kind of like shaking his head, you know, like, but you can kind of see the change.
Oh, yeah.
Where he just feels drawn to it. And it's just, I was not expecting him the first time I saw it to pick that up and take a big ass bite into it.
You know? Nobody was.
So it was just, that was out of nowhere. It's like, holy shit, you know, and he went all in. And what do you say that thing was made out of? It was like gelatin and
gelatin fruit cocktail,
like jelly or something in there.
It's black jelly, dye. But he said that it still tasted like shit.
I believe it. You know, even if it didn't taste bad, you know, it looked bad enough that your brain would probably tell you it was bad. You know what I mean?
Well, that's the thing. It's probably a visual thing too.
Yeah, probably had the worst texture in the world too. You know, it's like like a big old mushroom cap stuffed with mayonnaise or something. You know what I mean? It just be...
And he was getting into it too. He was like,
"Oh my god, yeah!"
Like they show close up of him like biting it and like pulling it, like so he was really in there, man.
He was ferocious. You know, maybe they only made one and they're like, you better make it good.
Make it count, buddy.
So, but then they added, you know, like animation. I mean, I don't think they were doing CGI here. I think they were doing animation because this was still film.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And, you see all like the spirit.
Like those orbs.
Whatever that was. The energy flowing into his body, you know. And that was cool looking, you know, and he just kind of like stood there, like arms stretched out, you know, just accepting it. Next kill was cool.
But the
coroner assistant came in.
Jason.
Yeah.
And the next coroner, the assistant came in. Mm-hmm. It's like, what did he go back to work? Like before, like, it's like, okay, I became Jason, but until I get somebody to kill, I'll continue working.
Yeah, it was like he was just sitting there trying to figure out what his next move was, you know, just kind of all hunched over the table, like growling a little bit, you know.
And the assistant Dean, what's his name? Dean Laurie. He's actually the co-writer of this.
Oh, shit. Yeah, that's right. There was basically three writers on this. Jay Hughley. Anna Marcus and Dean Laurie. So, and of course,
and he gave me one of my comments, one of my lines that I've said since I've heard this movie. I've used it in the chats. Remember, if you remember, I even said, I'll promise not to take a mango sized crap on The Exorcist. If we talk about it. I've used that for years because of this movie. I just thought that was genius.
Yeah. It's such a weird phrase, but I get it. Mangoes are pretty sizable, so I guess. Yeah. So it doesn't take much for Jason to escape the autopsy room and the office where they're performing this. He basically just walks out.
And we get the news flash.
Yeah.
Dead. But it's funny. It's like.
Yeah, he didn't like. When he didn't like Kane Hodder calling Jason a pussy.
A pussy. But like when they show the assistant, it's like his picture is him sitting in the lab like a few minutes before.
Yeah.
It's like when he knew he was going to die, so he like posed for a picture.
Yeah, what was this? Security camera footage that they just took stills from?
It was great.
I get what you're saying. Well, it's kind of like in part five where they're like explaining, you know, the killer at the end and they're going through his wallet. For some reason, he's got a picture of himself in there and he's got like newspaper clippings and there's a big old picture of Jason Voorhees in the newspaper. And I'm like, what the fuck? Who got a picture of Jason Voorhees? You know what I mean? So.
And there's another cool kill with him, because not only with him stabbing the thing, but when he pushes him down on that table with the grate.
You
can see his skin coming through like the holes.
Yeah, yeah. He mashed him like a you know, like a burger on a grill, man. It was just
it's like, how's this for a mango size crap?
Exactly. Oh man, that was pretty cool. Yeah, that was one thing that I will really say about this movie was like it was brutal as fuck, man. Like some of the kills were just crazy. They look gnarly and nasty. The effects were wonderful. And I would have to say that's for good reason, because KNB effects worked on this film. So three very famous effects artists who came together to form their own company, one of which being Greg Nicotero.
Yes.
So they did some really, really cool work on this movie. And I think that was just money well spent. I don't know if they were excited to work on this project. Maybe they were. I think they were, because they basically worked on every other horror, you know, type of movie imaginable. They're like, well, we got to get a piece of Friday the 13th. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of how I think that went. But hey, who knows what those conversations were like. So I liked the restaurant too. The restaurant was kind of cool. It was one of those like novelty places that was just like almost like a roadside attraction that was banking on, you know, the lore of Jason Voorhees. Everything on the menu had something to do with either the lake or Jason himself, you know, like a Jason burger or the Jason fingers, you know, or whatever. Like everything on the menu, the food items were all named after something related to.
And you see these patties? And you scoop them out and you make it look like a hockey mask. And see this? This makes a whole new patty. Hence the 2-for-1.
That's right. That's right. And they were pretty cool too. Rusty Schwimmer and Leslie Jordan were the couple who...
He is great.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, because he goes from... I mean, I'm a big... You ever watched the show Will and Grace?
Yeah.
He's on that show. He goes from being hysterical. He was in American Horror Story. He goes from one extreme to the other, and he sells it no matter what. He's like, and he's so likable no matter what he does. Like, if I see him in anything, like, I know I'm going to enjoy it. I know whatever character he's playing or whatever he's doing, it's going to be enjoyable.
Yeah.
He's great.
Yeah, I love their dynamic in this movie. I mean,
Hold me back!
They were the polar opposites.
Yeah.
You know, she was tall, he was short, she was butch, he was not. but it worked. Like, I really believe that a couple like that could exist.
That's what I'm saying. No matter how outlandish how he acts, he makes it believable. He sells it. So I love him.
We do get a diner scene. And we get Duke in there basically immediately trying to talk to
my problem with Duke is I like the character a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't think they had to make him so fucking douchey. Like,
agreed.
If he was really legit on this quest, and like when he starts talking to Erin Gray, he like really wants to help her. You know, but then when the sheriff comes and he's like, why don't you blow me right after your girl is done? Like, really?
Tried the Duke yet.
Yeah, she ain't. Like, now just stop it. I was like, see, now, like it makes the bounty hunter after Jason part less credible.
Yeah.
Because you're like, this guy's just a douchebag.
Yeah. At the same time, I think his character... I'm probably reaching here, but I think his character's seen enough of the world to have a healthy disrespect for small town law enforcement.
Yeah, because, I get that too.
You know, and he had a disrespect for the FBI too when they blew up Jason, you know, because he was sitting there in the bushes watching through the binoculars and he's like, I don't think so. You know what I mean? It's like you could tell he's a guy who knew more than what he was saying.
Well, in the blurb I read about him with the whole story with Jason killing his girlfriend, mm-hmm. he apparently was in law enforcement before bounty hunting.
Okay.
It said that's what Jason killing his girlfriend prompted him to go into law enforcement and then later bounty hunting. Whether if that's true or not, I don't know, but it makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah. You could use that as a storyline. I would accept it. Whether that's the one that was intended or not.
And he pulled a line right from Jaws. Right after the donut and the hot dog and the donut. And he asked for $5,500,000, whatever he asked. He's like, for that, you get the mask, the machete, the whole damn thing. I was like, God damn it.
Yeah, he did. He pulled a Quint. Holy shit.
I was like, holy shit. Well, there's a lot of film nods in this movie.
Oh, sure.
All over the place. I mean,
yeah.
The TV dude that's a douche that's going out with the girl, what's her name? Uh-huh. He's Robert Campbell for Robert England and Bruce Campbell. The sheriff, I have it written down. The sheriff, Billy Greenbush.
Yeah.
But his name in the movie is Sheriff Landis for John Landis. Like, there's little tropes all over this movie.
Yeah. 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 This movie seemed to do a lot of that, you know, and we got, well, now we call them Easter eggs. They weren't calling them Easter eggs then, but they would keep inputting little nods to other movies and other things all throughout this movie. I know I'm jumping around, but like at the Voorhees house in the basement, there was that big crate.
The crate that says North whatever expedition, that's from Creepshow.
Yeah. 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 I didn't know if it was, and I always wondered when I saw that crate in Creepshow, if it was like a nod to The Thing. You know what I mean?
I kind of could see that. It's a good.
Yeah. So I almost feel like it's kind of tied to both. But you're right. I think that's basically the crate from Creepshow.
Yeah, it absolutely is. I think it says the exact same thing, whatever expedition, if you look. Mm-hmm. And we have the biggest drop of all.
Yeah.
The
Necronomicon?
Yes. That actually caused a lot of shit online because people will say, oh, well, Jason's a deadite.
Yeah.
And they're like, no, fuck no, he's not a deadite. Well, like, but the Necronomicon was there. So
yeah.
I'm like,
yeah, yeah. And I don't think that the Necronomicon necessarily, you know, only means he's a deadite, you know. And he never specifically said that. I mean, he couldn't, you know, but it was just an idea. He wanted to put a suggestion in there, a reason for, you know, why, you know, Jason is this supernatural being. You know, it was a nice suggestion and a nod to another franchise that I really like.
Exactly.
And it did create questions, but I mean, you know, he didn't own any of that stuff. He couldn't like put it in there as lore. You know what I mean? It's just like, I'm just going to put this here. See what you guys think. You know, make up your own story.
Right.
And, you know, I kind of have fun with that. And he's talked about it, you know, in recent years where he's like, okay, well, you know, maybe he's not a deadite. Maybe he's just a revenant. You know what I mean? Where he's acting out on behalf of somebody else who's beyond the grave, you know. And I've heard that suggestion before. I think our friend Paul said it, where he felt that Jason's killing spree was basically an extension of his dead mother, like she was acting through his body, which that's another interesting theory that's never been suggested before that I can think of.
No.
So,
and the Voorhees obviously had a very nice house too.
I thought so. I like, would have lived there.
No, it would have been cool. Like
nice little fixer upper.
Like maybe showing like a flashback of Betsy Palmer or somebody even it looks like, but showing her in the house, like when she was younger or something.
Uh-huh.
It was just like, and this is the Voorhees house. You know, it's like this big, know?
Yeah. So whatever reason, Duke got arrested for his little stunt in the restaurant. I don't quite understand why. I mean, was it harassment? You know, I didn't hear a charge. You know,
they just
locked him up.
I mean, telling somebody's girlfriend to blow you is, I mean, it's rude, but it's not jail worthy. I mean,
yeah, they called it solicitation. What are they doing here? You know,
I mean, he didn't offer to pay for it. It was like,
So, but we get the I don't want to call him a boyfriend. He wasn't the boyfriend. He was, we'll call him the baby daddy.
Yeah.
Steven driving into town, you know, and picks up the hitchhikers. I don't know why they're hitchhiking. I mean, they're planning on going camping and they don't have a car.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's a little unusual, but he picked up the hitchhikers and they basically said they're going to Camp Crystal Lake. They're going to do some smoking, some fucking and whatever. And they're not going to worry about, you know, getting killed. He's like, all right. So he just drops him off, takes off. So,
and that girl was like, why don't you come? He's like, like, there's no guy that would have said no. I'm
sorry. Right. That
I'm sorry. What was going on?
That would have been
I was like,
a really difficult no. You know what I mean? There. It's like, you really have to be late for something or something way more important to say no to that, you know? But that's all right. We'll just say that he's, you know, he's one of the good guys, you know, and he's got a moral code and he's not going to compromise that. He's got somewhere to be.
Such bullshit.
To do the right thing.
It's almost as ridiculous as the towel not falling off.
So this is one of those added on scenes that was shot later and put into the movie because I guess they felt like there wasn't enough, you know, things that said Friday the 13th in this movie. So they did a wood scene. They did a camp scene. They did, you know, multiple kills. I thought it was interesting that they put a twist on the sex equals death thing. They did an unsafe sex equals death thing. Because they didn't get killed until after he was like, I don't want to wear the condom. She's like, all right, fuck it. Threw it away. But I don't know what that had to do with the girl outside. She got killed before that.
Yeah. You know,
she wasn't doing anything.
And apparently that's like, that came up like so many times that I was reading online.
Yeah.
One of the bloopers in the movies, like she tossed the condom in the tent, but then you see him step on the condom like outside, like how far did that thing go? Like,
yeah, it was right like, through the side of the closed. Tent.
So, like, how did like? I love when there's like stupid because they make me laugh. They don't bother. Yeah. I could care less. But there's people that like will bring out every little thing. Like, oh my god.
Yeah, well, they were taking their clothes off outside. Maybe one fell out of his pocket before they got in the tent. You know what I mean? Yeah, I did think of that too. Fence post kill was awesome.
Yes.
You know, that was probably one of the coolest kills that I've ever seen in a movie like this. And I mean, it wasn't just the stabbing through the side of the tent. It was the ripping up through her body. And I was like, oh my God, you know. It just looked great. It was awesome. Yeah. You know, him sitting there screaming, then getting sprayed in the face with her blood, you know, just to be killed off screen, man. That was a little disappointing. I kind of wanted to see him die, but I guess they spent enough money, you know, with the effect killing her there. So
I wonder if he's still nutted.
I'll allow it. I don't know.
What if you're like in mid and it's about that and like she's half, you got to finish. I mean,
well, if I ever meet him, I'll ask.
See, this is the immature. This is the shit I think about when I see.
Right.
When I see the shit.
Yeah. So this is all while he's still in the coroner's body, you know, but I guess the coroner is kind of winding down. He's no good anymore. He's got to find a new body. So manages to kill poor Edna with a car door and capture that other cop. And then you get that really strange, you know, homoerotic shaving.
Where did that scene come from?
I don't know, but I think it was put in there just to make the audience feel uncomfortable.
Like what? Yeah. Like, where did Jason get these little rubber shorty shorts from? Yeah. I put them in them, and then it's like, you know what? Now I'm going to shave you, too. It's like, I was like, you can't say anything like facial hair. The coroner had facial hair.
Yeah.
But he was like, no, I'm shaving your shit off. And you could tell that guy was annoyed as fuck. He's like, no, look, it took me to grow that mustache.
He kind of seems scared to me, so, which makes more sense, but I don't know. I guess he didn't like porn stashes, so he's like, we're shaving some bitch off before I transfer into this body.
Yeah.
You know? So, yeah, that was awesome. And no sooner is he getting that body that he goes after the half-sister, Diana. Our lovely waitress who ran into Creighton Duke in the previous scene.
Erin Gray.
That's right. Erin Gray.
I love Erin Gray.
So there's a struggle. It's not working out too well for her. But Steven just shows up. Good thing he decided not to stay with those kids at the lake. You know, otherwise he'd have been too late and Jason would have had his way. He did this awesome dive, like hits him, knocks him off, damn near knocked his head on a rocking chair that was in the room, you know, whacks an end table, you know, like it looked legit. Like this looked like a real fight, real struggle, you know.
And this is after she had like already put a bullet in the dude's head.
Right.
So he had basically come back, you know, was winning the struggle when Steven came in. And knocked him off, and the struggle continued. You know, Cop Jason picks the weirdest weapon of all out of like the knife holder. He pulls out the sharpening steel.
Yeah, yeah.
And whips that into her back. Now, of course, they struggle again. He ends up stabbing the guy through his back with a poker and throws him out the window. And of course, because
he sees himself in the mirror.
Yeah.
And he kind of like stopped. He was like, because now he looked in the mirror and it was hockey mask Jason looking back at him.
Yeah.
And he was like, what the fuck? He's like, what is. He had like a stupid look on his face. He was like, what? Like, and that's when he stabbed him.
Yeah. See, and that was an interesting mechanic there. You know, like every time he walked past a reflective surface, you could see that it was Jason.
Yes. You saw it with the coroner at the beginning.
Yeah. And I thought at first that was something just for the audience. You know what I mean? But then, you know, Erin Gray's character saw it.
Yes.
You know, she saw the reflection and immediately knew what was happening and she was in trouble. Which I thought was a weird decision. Oh, everybody can see this, you know. And I didn't quite understand that, but I just kind of accepted it. They didn't do it a ton.
It was confirmation that it was Jason.
Yeah.
You know, so if anybody would have any doubts, it's like, well, obviously because they don't see the mask. And if they had their doubts, it's like, oh, we walk by. Look, it really is Jason.
Yeah. So yeah, unfortunately, she dies and a deputy comes in. He gets arrested. So Steven's going to jail.
I was upset. I wanted more Erin Gray in the movie.
Yeah, I kind of did too, you know, but I guess they could only talk.
She's like childhood crush part. To me.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right. You said you like to watch the old Buck Rogers series.
I would take her now, even if she's old, and knowing that Buck Rogers banged her like a screen door in a windstorm.
Damn.
I love her. I really do. When she dies, like, that's it. No more Erin Gray. But.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Now she looked good in this movie, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So then we get the weird scene, you know, him and Creighton Duke side by side in cell, you know, and they just start talking. It's like, I don't know. Just Duke seems to know too much.
Yes.
You know,
and I think that's what I'm saying. They should have. Granted, I know they didn't have time to go into a big backstory.
Yeah.
But they should have dropped like a hint of how he knows what he knows.
Yeah.
It's just like you have to, you know, Just believe it. That just take their word for it. That he knows what's going on.
Yeah, and he immediately knows this guy's involved. That he's connected to this family.
Yes.
And exactly how. So it's like he's done his research on everybody and knows mm-hmm. who this guy is. And so like he baits him into this conversation, you know, and gets him interested in what he needs to know about the situation. And like he makes him pay a price for all the information that he gives him by breaking two of his fingers.
Yeah.
You know, he'll ask a question. Oh, that's an expensive question. Are you willing to pay the price? Breaks a finger, tells him what he wants to know. And he's like, that's an expensive question. Breaks another finger, you know, and like fakes him out like he's going to break a third finger, you know, just to find out if he's really willing to do it. Yeah. You know,
this one's on the house.
Yeah, this one's on the house.
But you know what made me annoyed? Steven, after when he said that, this one's on the house, Steven looked at him like, oh, really? That's cool. I was like, that still would have been like, fuck you. You broke two of my fucking fingers. Like, now I'm supposed to like you because you let me go. What? I still
got. Oh, thank goodness. You're a good guy. You, I can't you didn't break a third finger. I can't off
because my fucking fingers broke.
Yeah. So basically, he's like, you know, get to the Voorhees house, find proof. You got to convince her. You know what I mean? Of what this is. And she's the only one that can kill him. So he learns a lot in a short amount of time and just absorbs it, just believes it. You know what I mean? Like, he didn't question him once. Just like, yeah, get the fuck out of here. You're fucking with me. You know what I mean? Yeah, he was convincing enough that he believed everything that he was saying. He's like, all right, I'm in. And basically makes a scene. You get Kip Marcus coming in there as Randy. And he grabs a hold of him, you know, like pulls his gun. And he's like, all right, let me out.
I would have called this bluff. Like, they're childhood friends. You know he's not going to shoot you. I mean, like, if you really know he's not a bad guy, he's not going to shoot you.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah. Yeah, we don't have to go through the whole movie. But, I mean, favorite scenes, I mean.
So who's Jason now? Still the cop? Still shorty short rubber pants cop?
Yeah. Yeah, because the new boyfriend. So, like, I called Steven baby daddy.
Baby daddy.
So
he gets out of jail now and goes back to the house.
Yeah, Diana's daughter, you know, had a baby, which is Steven's baby.
Yes.
We established this early in the movie, even though we didn't talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's who he has to convince. So... her mother's dead already, so she's the one who has to be convinced that she's the only one who can kill Jason. And that's his goal, is to go do that. And of course, he goes to the Voorhees house to try to find proof, as directed by Creighton Duke. Finds the Necronomicon, all that stuff. Well, the new boyfriend, the newscaster guy, the real douchey guy, steals her mother's body from the morgue and takes it to the Voorhees house. And shoves it into the closet where Steven basically fell through the floor. And he was trying not to fall all the way down to the basement.
And that's where he overheard him.
Yeah.
His whole plan. Basically, he didn't give a shit about the girl. He just wants the Voorhees story.
Yeah, he wants the Voorhees story. So
I get the prop guys here to put some body parts here and make it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's all he's really going to do. So he throws the body into the closet, you know, it lands on him, falls down in the basement, you know, and that's when, you know, cop Jason comes in
and gives him the tongue down of a lifetime.
Yeah. Yeah. He beats his ass up and transfers, you know, from the cop's body into his, because we know his body's done. He's had a headshot. He's had, you know, a fire poker through his body. You know, he's on borrowed time. So, like, so as soon as that transfers over, he fucking melts. He just,
that was a good scene, too.
Turns to slime and starts, like, decomposing, like, on the spot. I mean,
like, I got big time Raiders of the Lost Ark vibes.
Yeah. I got Raiders of the Lost Ark vibes. I got Evil Dead 2 vibes. I've got the shunting vibes, you know?
Yeah. That was a really cool scene.
Yeah, I got RoboCop vibes. You know, the guy who got soaked in the toxic waste and started to melt on screen.
Yeah.
You know, which probably happened after this movie. Maybe I got the timeline right. Somewhere around this time, anyway. Yeah, super cool effects. That was awesome, especially when his jaw fell off. I mean, stuck to the floor and, like, ripped off. I mean...
And, like, they didn't rush it or cut it. Like, you sat there for a minute or two and actually watched this.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I should throw in the part where Steven, after he broke out of jail and went to the house, got out of there, went to get his girlfriend or his baby mama.
Well, the baby, the other waitress who was watching the baby brought her to the diner. And first the owner, the chick was like, get her out of the scene, a friggin' take care.
Yeah, exactly. So the baby's not even with her right now. So he goes to the house and basically saves her from the newscaster boyfriend, who's now Jason. Runs him over with the car, takes off with her. She's pissed off. You just killed my boyfriend, you know, and kicks him out of the car and takes off. So and he gets picked up by his cop buddy, Randy again. So he allows himself to be arrested, goes back to the station. You know, no sooner they get there than the newscaster boyfriend that he just ran over is there, and he's basically taking everybody out in the place.
Yeah.
You know, does that awesome leap where he, like, gets the handcuffs from behind his back to the front of his body, you know, elbows his buddy in the face, takes the gun and shoots him until he empties the weapon and they get the hell out of there. Yeah, a lot of cool.
I'd be dead because that would never happen with me.
Yeah, I don't think I'm athletic enough to do that either. I'd trip on that shit. I'd fall. I'd break my wrist. You know?
I fall putting my underwear on. Can you imagine me trying to do that fucking jump? Get the fuck.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, Grayton breaks out of jail too. He ends up, we find out he ends up going to the diner and grabs the baby, leaves a note. But we don't see that for a little bit.
We get some good kills at the diner, though.
We get some awesome kills at the diner. Holy crap. I mean, not only do we get some good shotgun blasts, you know, we get...
we have the kid gets killed outside, the son.
Yeah.
And he has a similar... He didn't impale him with it, but he breaks it just like he did in Texas Chainsaw, like with the forearm.
Yeah. Broke his forearm. Blast him up against the glass of the door. You know, dude busts in. They shoot him a bunch of times.
And that scene, the gun they have in it, that's like a Grail gun for me.
Oh, yeah? What'd you say it was again?
It's a LAR Grizzly. Now, and I only noticed because there's a site, the International Movie Firearms Database.
Okay.
Great site.
Okay.
You could literally type in any movie. Like, if you see what gun they're using, you're not sure, you put the title of the movie in, and it gives you a whole rundown of every firearm, and even scenes, pictures from the scene the gun was in it.
Huh.
So, I used to do this more religiously, and probably when I was buying a lot of guns, and so I would do this, I was on the site constantly, every movie, and I saw that gun, and I said, it's like, looks like a 1911, like a Colt. But I said, it's big. I said, that can't be. And so I looked it up. And it's actually the designer of that gun actually got two Colt 1911s, cut them in half, and made a bigger one. And they actually manufactured a cartridge called 45 Winchester Mag, which is like double the size of a 45 ACP. And they stopped making them like in the late 90s. But, like, they're impossible to get. But, like, there was a point where I was after one of those, and can't find them anywhere.
Yeah. And didn't the barrel, like, extend out from the slide?
Had an extended port. Oh, it was a nice friggin' gun.
Yeah. That's interesting.
It was really...
I did notice that it was a unique-looking gun, but I had no idea. I didn't know what the hell it was.
Like I said, it was impossible to get when I looked it up probably 15 years ago. But so now it's like, and also the ammo too, it's not a big demand for 45 Winchester,
right? And were there any other, like, weapons that were outfitted with that particular.
I think cartridge. It was manufactured for that gun.
Yeah. So even that. So even if you had one, you'd end up having to like do your own reloads and stuff like that.
Yeah. And it's comparable to a 44 mag. Like I read both. Some people say the 44 Magnum is more powerful. Other sites say this trumped the 44 mag. I don't know. Like you'll know. I guess I'll never know because I'll never have one because it's obsolete.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
That'll be like a lottery gun if I hit the Powerball.
Yeah. Then you'll go I'll find be able one.
To track one down.
Fair enough. So yeah, we get poor Shelby played by Leslie Jordan. He gets his head dunked into the French fryer. That sucked. Holy shit. And Rusty Schwimmer, or Joey B, as we should call her, got elbowed in the face and basically her jaw just like busted and like yeah.
The whole fucking face was like that yeah. was that was a great effect. That was
a great look.
Yeah. That was awesome.
Yeah. But yeah. And then, you know, the waitress just goes all freaking Rambo, you know, and she's back there like
right
shooting him with the shotgun rounds and everything else. She picks up something and impales him, you know, and then he grabs her, impales her, and then suddenly she's gone. But you know, she did a great job there, just trying to defend these people. So the girlfriend takes off, and he tries to run her down. You know, Steven tries to run her down, and he can't catch her before she takes off. And he goes back in to find out what it was that she looked at, finds a note that the waitress had. And basically it was from Duke saying, got your baby, you know, come to the Voorhees house alone, you know, so he knows that's where she's going. So this is kind of like the final, you know, scene of the movie. There, everybody is showing up at the Voorhees house. You got Creighton Duke there already with the baby, you know, and she shows up alone, and he was like, oh, you're alone. He's like, good, you know, that type of shit. And she's upset. He's like, hey, look, just give me 2 minutes. And, you know, puts a knife down that he's holding, hands her the baby, and they sit there and have a conversation. And this is where, like, you get a little bit more of the lore, and he finally convinces her that there's something special about her, because he tosses her the knife. When she catches it, it basically extends into this sword type thing.
Yeah.
That it only happened when she touched it. So, I mean, was that a little hokey? Maybe a little bit.
Absolutely, you know? But it worked.
But at this point, I was having fun, yeah. So I really didn't care. You know, I was like, "What's gonna happen?" You know.
So now we don't see what happens to the boyfriend, because last we saw the chick was shooting him with the shotgun, and he impaled her.
Yeah.
So now the two cops come in. The younger cop and the sheriff.
Yeah.
And this is where I said you get like the thing vibes. It's because he's like, kill them both.
Yeah. Yeah. Because you don't know who's who.
Yeah. And you don't know who. Now you absolutely don't know who Jason is.
Yeah. And that's the thing where it's like you think it's the sheriff, but turns out it's not. It's the other guy.
After she stabbed him, like, oops, sorry.
Yeah, oops, sorry about that, you know, and you find out that it's Randy's character who's Jason now, and, you know, he's winning once again. Boyfriend comes in, you know, with that big old machete-looking type knife that he brought from the restaurant and, like, cuts him right across the neck, and that was a really cool effect because, like, it didn't cut his head completely off.
It just,
you know. It severed a good way through, falls down on the ground, and then like the creature inside starts crawling out the neck and pushes the head over to the side. That was a really cool look. And little side story, you know, that head, which was of Adam Marcus's brother Kip, got used again about 30 years later in Secret Santa. So
Really?
Yeah. Well, remember the shovel scene in Secret Santa? They reused the head there. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, so if you go back and look real close, maybe you'll recognize it.
Now
I... Yeah. So, yeah, I wanted to throw that in there. And shout out to Secret Santa. That movie's awesome.
Yes.
You got that damn little critter running around and it just crawled out of the deputy's body. And, you know, Duke gets attacked, throws it. It falls down into the basement. You know, Duke's down there. He's crawling his way out. And they realize, you know, suddenly that the thing's down there in the basement. You know, Diana's body's down there. And he's like, it's reborn through Voorhees' blood, right? Does it have to be alive? And he's like, no. He's like, Diana's body was down there. And they're like, oh, shit.
And when he jumps out, the whole theater went friggin' nuts.
Yeah.
It was like the whole theater was cheering. It was,
yeah. And you pointed out this inconsistency when we watched this movie the other night, and somebody had mentioned it to me before, and you're right. Why when he was reborn was he reborn into the state that he was in the beginning of the movie? You know, we're talking same clothes, same mask, same look. You know what I mean? It's like everything just regenerated now that he was born through this person's body. Okay. Yeah, you're right. That doesn't make a ton of sense, but you know,
it doesn't.
This is how we knew him when we saw him earlier in the movie. So I'm like, okay, I'm still on the ride here. I'm still enjoying myself. I'm gonna just go with
100%.
Yeah. So you get the fight scene. They end up outside through the greenhouse glass. You know, for some reason the Voorheeses were very disorganized. They left all their gardening tools outside. He hits him with a freaking rake. He ends up hitting him with a shovel. I don't remember what the hell else was out there. You know,
Jason throws Steven a beat down here. Like it doesn't even like, it's not even like he just, you know, where he could have probably just killed him. He's like, no, I'm going to slap the shit out of you for a while.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. He's playing with him now.
Yeah.
He even like picked up the end of that jungle gym and like rolled it at him and shit, you know, which weren't you saying that was from The Birds?
The movie The Birds. That's what's good. Sometimes when you watch a movie on Amazon,
if
you put your cursor over the screen, it'll give you like trivia notes on the side.
Yeah.
It's used in the motion picture The Birds. So I'm like,
yeah. I mean, I've seen pictures of that thing, you know, and I guess they do look similar. I guess it could be.
I guess after they cleaned all the bird shit off it.
Yeah. And then filmed it in color. Yeah. You know? But yeah. So you think he's getting ready to bite it, you know, and she just comes rushing out there, jumps on his back, stabs him through the front of the chest, not through the back or anything. She's like, I've got to get him through the front, and stabs him. And next thing you know, you have that
those big excellent fucking scene meat where, hands.
Yeah, all the shit shooting out of his body, you know, the weirdo hands come up out of the ground, basically drag him down into the ground. So technically that's him going to hell. And I like the little thing that they did at the end. Apparently that was kind of a last minute thing that Adam Marcus tried to get permission for, since New Line owned Freddy. He had asked permission to borrow Freddy's glove and could he use Freddy's laugh? Because he wanted to do that scene at the end where Freddy's glove comes up, grabs the mask, you hear the laugh and just disappears into the dirt. And you also pointed out that Kane Hodder,
that was Kane Hodder's hand
in more the or less. Glove. He's like he didn't even like give people an option. He's like, I'm doing that. He's like, I'm putting the glove on. I'm doing this thing.
Look at Robert Englund's arm and look at the arm that comes out. That's like a beefy arm that comes out.
Yeah. But who could blame him? You know what I mean? It's
who
like,
wouldn't want to do that.
Yeah. Yeah. And he's like, and it's, as you say, you know, he's probably the only Jason
technically
Voorhees player who
also technically played Freddy Krueger.
Yes.
Unless somebody else has done it since.
Maybe that's why he wanted to do that, just so he could get that under his belt.
I know we gushed over this movie. It's, I don't know. A lot of people hate it. A lot of people online specifically. Oh, my God. There's this one, like, fan group that I'm a part of. I'm almost ready to leave the group. Because I see all these horrible comments about this movie, and I'm just like, and I want to argue with them. Like, no, it's pointless. Don't do it. You know, it's like you don't need validation from these people. You don't have to convince them. You can love this movie without them. You know, and I do. So,
and like I've said it once before, in '93 when I was in the movie theater, you didn't have all this media. You know what? I got a new Jason movie. So that's all you can. It's like you didn't have much other to go on.
Yeah.
So, and you know what? I'm a big Kevin Smith fan.
Yeah.
One of the things I love about Kevin Smith, and he said it many times, he goes, if I like a movie, if I love a movie, he goes, I'll blow the shit out of it. Mm-hmm. He goes, if I don't like a movie, you just won't hear me say anything.
Yeah.
He goes, because there's too much negativity.
Yeah.
Like the new Star Wars came, and he goes, sometimes, like, kind of like what I said, he goes, people are ready to judge coming out of the gate before they even see a movie. Mm-hmm. The new Star Wars trilogy, the new ones that came out.
Yeah.
I had issues with them, being a big Star Wars fan myself. But the way Kevin put it, he said, you know what? He goes, there are things I like, I dislike, there are things I agree with. But you know what? He goes, I'm sitting in the movie theater watching a Star Wars movie and seeing TIE fighters and fucking... He goes, it might not be 100% whatever, but it's better than not having nothing. They gave, you know... He goes, yeah. So just take what they give you and instead of trying to tear it apart and tear it down, just sit back and try and enjoy it.
Yeah.
And that's what I do with movies like this. It's like, I'm not going to tear apart. No, Jason wasn't in the whole movie. It was like, you know what? They put a creative spin on it. And it's entertaining as fuck, in my opinion. I like it.
Yeah. Yeah. One thing you can definitely say, it was original.
No, definitely.
So, I don't know if you're ready to rate this thing or not. I mean, I'm ready to rate it. I used my checklist, of course. I found it interesting. I found it thought-provoking. I liked some of the direction choices that happened. I thought there was good visuals in it, inventive camera work, good lighting. You know, it was paced well, smooth transitions. Actors were cool. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Good sets, good wardrobe, good props. I mean, I even like the soundtrack. I mean, I'm pretty sure they got, you know, Henry Manfredini back in on this thing. He did, he at least did the opening credit music, and probably a few other things throughout. I like the design, you know. I found it to be memorable. I'd watch it again. I have watched it.
I watched it
multiple times.
I watched it 2 times in 2 days.
Yeah. So, I gave this 23 out of 30 criteria points. I gave it a +2 because, you know, I like the inventiveness of it and how they tried to use some of the mechanics of like the Necronomicon and a couple other things to kind of explain some of the things that were plot holes.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people didn't get it. You know, a lot of people thought it was more confusing, but I didn't feel that way. I accept some of the explanations that I've learned. So it's 25 out of 30. I'm going to give it an 83% or an 8.3 out of 10.
I'm probably going to go. Normally, I would go 7.5, 8 out of 10.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? Just to spite all of our hoser friends, I'm going fucking 9 out of 10. Because fuck you. Fuck you and your poor taste in movies. If you don't like it.
Yeah.
You're stupid. I don't care.
Yeah, you get the fuck you score. We're going to give you the score that makes you angry. Perfect. I like it.
Fucking watch E.T.
Anyhow, thanks for hanging out with us. I hope you're having a good time. And if you made it this far, I appreciate you very much. If we offended you, come on, man. It's a movie.
If we offended you, Bafungal.
And this is just our and this is just our opinion. So anyhow, on behalf of myself and Mike, my final words to you are, remember,
Spider, you son of a